Karl Racine is the first elected Attorney General in the District of Columbia. He ran re-election with 93% of the vote, unopposed. His mandate is local, but he's also garnered national attention for his role in the National Association of Attorneys General and for his leadership in suing the current president under the Emoluments Clause. Welcome, Mr. Racine.
It's so great good to have be you. With you, Dr. Malveaux.
Well, look, before we, you know, I have so many questions for you, but what is an emolument? What is the clause, and how do you get to sue that man?
Sure. Well, let's talk about what an emolument is, and let's talk about why we sued President Trump in the first place. We sued President Trump under the Emoluments Clause because that clause is this country's first anti-corruption law. It's in the Constitution. And what it provides is that no federal office holder, and of course the president is a federal office holder, shall receive an emoluments, we'll talk about that, from any foreign sovereign or any domestic state. The court in Greenbelt, Maryland, went with our interpretation of an emolument as anything of value. And of course, money is something of value. President Trump, as we know, has the Trump Hotel in Washington, D.C. That's why we sued. He's profiting from the White House right at that Trump Hotel in Washington, D.C. And we know from public reports and our own investigation that foreign countries are doing business in that hotel. And of course, that's a way for them to give the President of the United States cash money. Now you might ask, why haven't other presidents been accused of violating the Emoluments Clause? It's a simple reason. Every other president that came in having a business absolutely separated themselves from their business. A blind trust, a valid blind trust. Jimmy Carter had a peanut farm, right?
Yeah.
He separated himself completely from the business. President Trump, defying the Constitution, said, it's okay, I can be president and get paid too. That's why we're suing him.
And that's what he's been doing. But now you, not only the District of Columbia, as AG of the District of Columbia, you brought suit, but you were able to convince how many other attorneys general to go
along? Well, this one is a little peculiar. So Maryland, Brian Frosch, my dear friend in Maryland, and the District of Columbia brought suit against Donald Trump because the basis of our suit for standing was the business at that Trump Hotel. As you know, the hospitality industry in the District of Columbia and indeed the greater Washington, D.C. area to include Maryland is quite significant. What we allege is that we have standing because of the investment that our government makes in that industry and the fact that we know that clients, foreign governments especially, are choosing to pay honor to the president by going to that particular hotel. The court in Maryland found that we had standing on that basis, as well as two additional bases. Now, I should tell you that this meeting, our interview is timely. Next week, on the 19th of March, we'll be down before the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, seeking to defend the district court's decision in our favor. We'd like to win that appeal so that we can start getting documents from the president.
And there have to be plenty of documents. I mean, I have Republican friends who live at the Trump Hotel. I mean, they have the temerity to call me from time to time and say, come and have a drink with us. I'm like, on the corner of 14th and Q maybe, but I'm not going down there. Clearly the president is benefiting.
There's no doubt about it. And you know, to be sure, it's a little bit rich for my taste as well. So I've not been to the Trump Hotel. But we know, for example, that not only foreign sovereigns are going there. The Trump Hotel in New York, let me give you an example. Last year, they were in the red until about 1 week before the end of the fourth quarter. That's when Saudi Arabia booked up a whole bunch of floors, unclear as to whether anybody stayed in those rooms. And all of a sudden, guess what? The Trump business in New York turned a profit of 19% as a result of a last minute investment by the Saudi government. Now, here's the problem with the Emoluments Clause and the reason why it's there. We deserve to have a president of the United States who's focusing all of his time on the country's interest. We don't know, for example, in the case of Jamal Khashoggi, the Washington Post journalist who was brutally murdered by the Saudi regime. We don't know whether President Trump is going soft on Saudi for business reasons or
for kickback,
or for reasons related to our interest. No American or resident of this country should have to think for a minute whether they agree or disagree with their president. Is the president working for us, or is he playing for his own personal interests? That's why we brought suit.
Well, that's, I commend you. I admire it. We could talk about that man and all of his whatever for our whole half hour. We're not going to do that because
okay.
We could talk about Mar-a-Lago and the dues there.
Sure.
Ivanka's trademarks that she got in China. Da-da. We're not going to do all that. I really want to talk more about what you're doing, especially here in the district. Now, you, the AGs met here.
Yes.
A couple weeks ago. And what happened? What were the other than the fact that you have a new best friend?
Well, it was a peculiar meeting. But I got to say, when the National Association of Attorney General, which I'm the vice president of the organization, is a bipartisan organization, and it's customary for the president of the United States at least once in his term to invite the AGs, all the AGs, over to the White House. Now the president did that 2 years ago. So I've got to say, I give him credit for inviting all of the AGs over again, even inviting Democratic AGs like me, who are suing him. So we went to the White House, and it was quite interesting. I thought it was actually a productive session. Initially, we had a thought-provoking, interactive panel. The president didn't participate on that panel. Kellyanne Conway and other policy people, including a very, very impressive African-American man named Jerron Smith, who does the work on criminal justice reform. We talked about issues concerning the opioid crisis as well as criminal justice reform. And it was a give and take. And as you might imagine, many of the Democratic AGs had a different perspective than the administration. I will say this, however, on criminal justice reform, Kellyanne Conway, prior to asking me a question, noted the work that our office is doing. She was quite familiar with it, familiar with our restorative justice efforts. We can talk about that if you like. Familiar with our diversion program, familiar with our violence interruption program, and very familiar also with the heart of what underlies our work, trauma detection and trauma treatment.
So criminal justice reform has gotten a lot of traction lately after that Kardashian woman went to the president and got a pardon for an older black woman who'd
sure.
been convicted of a drug deal. What's your take on, I mean, we've heard a lot of rhetoric, but this first step piece of legislation that the president signed seems to me to be fairly weak.
Well, I can understand why folks may think it's fairly weak. I can tell you that at the end of the day, the ACLU jumped on board, the Urban League was on board, the NAACP was not. My organization, National Association of Attorney Generals, jumped on board because while perhaps not having everything in the legislation, it was a great first step. It was actually well named. And so the First Step Act really focused on returning citizens, providing more programming, education, vocational training in the prisons. That's really important. That it's quite a change from what Jeff Sessions did when he first got here and became the Attorney General. One of Jeff Sessions' first acts was to fire a very highly regarded person at BOP who was the Chancellor of Education at BOP.
Wow.
President Obama put her in that office and named the position for the first time. So the First Step Act was an absolute renunciation of what Jeff Sessions was trying to do. The First Step Act also is seeking to find ways to understand how to reduce recidivism. Let me make a couple points that people may not well understand. Jared Kushner is really interested in this. Jared Kushner's father was convicted of a serious crime and served serious time. Jared Kushner, I'm not here to extol his virtues in all areas, but I am here to say that he is committed to these issues. And again, I want to highlight Jerron Smith over there at the White House, an African-American man born in Cleveland, Ohio, lives in Ward 8. He is dead serious about these issues. I'm happy to tell you that I met with him just yesterday for 2 hours as we're trying to push through other things that we can get done.
So you got a second term. You won your second term just overwhelmingly. What are your priorities for this second term?
You know, we play real big on offense is what I'd like to say when it comes to criminal justice reform. In the District of Columbia, as you know, we're a kind of an unusual jurisdiction. So the Office of Attorney General has only small jurisdiction over adults. The federal folks, that's the U.S. Attorney's Office, is the prosecutor for most adult crimes in the district. We have a great playing field, however, in the juvenile justice space. And as I said, we're playing on the offense. What you're going to see in the second term is renewed energy and focus around interrupting violence. We launched a program called Cure the Streets in two sites, one site in Ward 8, another site in Ward 5. We selected those sites because those sites over a period of 3 to 5 years were the most violent sites in the District of Columbia. We've been on the ground now since August 23rd. We have 20 employees, most of whom are returning citizens. They're getting paid at least $40,000 a year. They're extremely well trained. I can report to you that as of this morning, there have been zero murders in those two sites.
How do you do that?
Here's what the Cure the Streets model is based on. It's based on essentially three acts. Number one, our folks are really well trained on mediation and de-escalation of violence. So what do? They actually go into the community looking to identify individuals who are causing harm, getting up in their face politely, trying to establish a relationship of trust, and simply trying to get them to understand that maybe there are alternatives to what they're doing, and if they're up for it, they'll connect them to the kinds of services and opportunities that could lead to people moving away from crime. That's step one. Step two, again, is just connecting them up with services. Step three is really important. That is where you really join with the community and empower the community to speak its values. These communities are sick and tired of the violence, and now they're letting it be known. We have peace walks, we have cookouts, we have gatherings in the physical two sites that we are. You go to those sites, and I invite you and your show to attend those sites. What you'll see is that the young kids in those areas come there for positive activity, for jokes, and also for wisdom. Importantly, in those two site areas, our Cure the Streets folks are walking every kid who goes to an elementary school, middle school, or high school on that site to and from school. Safe passage is happening.
Wow.
And I'm going to announce very soon an extraordinary partnership that we just formed with a gentleman named Dr. Beal and his great team, a Haitian doctor, Dr. D, is extraordinary. They will actually operate in Ward 8 and Ward 5. They're going to specifically operate right in the geographic area of our two sites. And what they're going to do is focus on babies. Babies from day 1 to year 5. The overwhelming data shows that kids from day 1 to day 5 who are not loved, do not form bonds, appropriate bonds with their parent, whose parents aren't trained as to how to be a mom, how to be a dad, those kids are falling behind. By the time they're 6 years old, they are significantly behind. By the time they're 11 years old, there are massive problems with truancy. And by the time they're 13, 14, those kids are entering into the criminal justice system and the foster system. What we're gonna do is play on offense, and we're gonna go in there in a community manner and help that community rise above its condition.
Now, this sounds like a combination of social work at some level. My mom was a social worker, so
I love it.
So a combination of social work with your street workers, early intervention in terms of these physicians, and perhaps some truancy prevention in terms of the walking folks to school and doing some things like that. How big of an area of Ward 8 is this happening in?
It's an excellent question. So it's a pretty small geographic area, and we're talking about probably a square mile and a half. There are a lot of people who live in that area.
How many square blocks?
That I don't know. Okay. But like I said, I'll invite you out there and I'll give you that information. But here's the point. The point is, those two sites were, over a period of 3 to 5 years, looking at the data was our guide, the two most dangerous clusters is what they're called in the District of Columbia. We're looking to interrupt the violence and also now to help train young mothers on how to be excellent parents, help train young fathers to get involved in the life of their kids, and also making sure those kids are getting all the pediatric exams and so that we're confronting the trauma that they confront every day right on, head on.
I love it. I mean, it seems like the kind of thing that needs to happen. Can I ask how expensive it is?
Sure. So the Cure the Streets model itself, we got $360,000 from the council around Memorial Day last year, and that money was to last until September 30. OAG, the Office of Attorney General, then put in another $400,000 of our own money. And then most recently, we solicited a private funder to provide $2 million that would allow us to really go through with these micro pilots all the way through July 2020. So if you add all that up, that's about $2.7 million. Here's another way to frame the question. What is the cost of a single murder that traumatizes an entire community? What is the cost of a kid who has significant trauma that goes untreated, cycles in and out of the foster care system, becomes involved in human sex trafficking, and lo and behold, becomes, you know, unfortunately aggressive and violent in the community? $2.8 million for this micro pilot.
This is over a 2-year
period. This is almost a 2-year period.
Okay.
For this micro pilot is peanuts. In the District of Columbia, the budget is $14.5 billion.
And we have a surplus of how much?
We've got a lot of money here. And to be quite honest, we've made decisions to not invest in evidence-based services like the ones we're talking about that can help lift our people up. Our people were not born and put in this country and put on this planet to be violent. They weren't born to be put on this planet to be uneducated. They weren't born and put in this planet to be without jobs. We are fully capable of doing better, and all our government has to do is just a little more smart investment.
I love your passion on this. I think it's really important. We need to have more leaders who have this kind of passion.
Now, there are leaders in town that have passion around other issues.
Well, there you have it.
And that's my point. I mean, and look, I get it. Development is important.
Don't get me started, Karl.
Here's my point. And let me just give you an example. We go begging for money. The first time we asked the city for money for Cure the Streets, I wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post. I think it was in early 2017 or late 2016. Guess what the response was? Quiet. Crickets. Okay? Crickets. Yet we can find $65 million really easily to give to Ted Leonsis of Monumental Sports, owns the Wizards, owns the Caps, so he can go build a practice stadium in Ward 8. Now, I love development in Ward 8. I don't know whether a billionaire needed $65 million.
I mean, the way that we subsidize millionaires in terms of development, to me, is criminal. And it's poor priorities. You can't.
Well, you know, sadly, it's legal, but here's the point. It is criminal, especially when we're not focused on the people who need it the most. Instead, even in these development deals, guess what the argument is? A trickle down.
And it doesn't trickle down.
It never has.
We don't see it trickle down. I mean, that's just a justification for politicians to give their friends money. One of the things you're doing, one of the things I love about your position, you have enormous discretion.
I love that.
You can sue just about anybody you want to. You got a pending lawsuit against slumlords. Tell me a bit about that.
Oh, we've been at it for, my goodness, 4 years now. And so this is why it's important that our office is an independent office of attorney general. Prior to my election, the office was appointed by the mayor. And for good reason, the attorney general was the mayor's lawyer. In a referendum, the residents of the District of Columbia, 83%, said no more. We want to have an AG that we can fire if he's not doing the job for the city. And so I'm the elected, I'm accountable. Now, you might remember one of the first things, unfortunately, that occurred during my first year in office was that the executive office of the mayor decided to try to strip us of our independence.
I remember that.
They said, forget about what the voters think. Let's make this guy report to us. We'll decide whether he sues a slumlord. How do you like that? So being independent, it allows us to go out in the community, listen to the community. When the community talks about the conditions in which they live, where when it's cold outside, it's freezing in their units. Yes. There's water, mold, rats, rodents, mold. As I said, we can go in and bring suit.
So we it doesn't matter who the slumlord is related
we
to.
We don't care how much the slumlord has contributed to members of the council or the mayor. And we don't care if we don't get a dime from that slumlord. In fact, we never solicit slumlords. The long and short of it is the city's largest slumlord had the most contracts with the city housing agency. Okay. Sanford Capital, we sued them so much, so hard, so legally correct, that as a result of judgments against them, they decided and agreed that they would leave the District of Columbia and not come back for 7 years.
I love it. My hat is off to you. They sued Facebook too. Tell me about that.
You know, people ask about Facebook, and what they say sometimes is the wrong thing. They say Karl Racine in that office is suing Facebook because he wants headlines. Okay. I posit that argument, I put it to the side. I can tell you why we're suing Facebook. Do you know that Facebook, through its breach, data breach, that they allowed, you know, other applications to access all manner of user information? Do you know how many DC users there are of Facebook?
Probably as many DC users as there are residents.
Try half of the residents of the District of Columbia, about 340,000 residents, had their personal user information misused. Facebook has repeatedly told half-truths about its privacy policy. It's repeatedly not even lived up to it. Mark Zuckerberg himself said, we breached the trust of our users. We're suing Facebook because they've injured DC consumers. That's why we sued them in a DC court. That's why I'm very confident at the end of this case, a DC court, if we present a case that we think we can, is going to conclude that Facebook violated our rights.
Wow, and I'm on Facebook all the time.
And I look here, I don't diss
Facebook. I
hope they do a better job. And I hope they tell us when they're doing things with our personal information that they promise not to.
You've alarmed me. I have friends who've gotten off Facebook because they say their information has been compromised. I'm like, well, yeah, but they haven't done anything that bad. But we'll have to talk about that later.
We can. I'll just say one thing about Facebook, and I'm going to actually give them credit. All right? Okay. After our lawsuit, and while during the pendency of very important settlement discussions with the FTC, Facebook has put in numerous changes.
Okay.
Now, putting in numerous changes is good. We're suing you for past bad acts.
Good. I feel better. But I feel better with you and the job just in general. I think that we are going to see enormous progress. Quick, another lawsuit. Providence Hospital.
Yes.
We now have much less health care east of the river. You are suing and then you drop the suit. Tell me why.
We got involved too late. Look, Providence, I think, made it clear as to what their game plan was, that they were going to move out of the city. In order for us to really build the case in the first instance to stop them from moving, we need to get out there and tell them they can't do it early. And in this case, to be quite honest, the government didn't do that. When we filed, it was a dollar short and a couple weeks late. That's why we dismissed our appeal. There is an investigation that is underway by my office in regards to certain fees that Providence paid to its parent company. It's important that we learn whether the parent company was unduly charging Providence Hospital and perhaps wasting its assets. So that matter is not over, and that is an investigation, like I said, that we're pursuing.
How can that investigation help people east of the river who have diminished health care opportunities?
Dr. Malveaux, it's an excellent question. The investigation will not lead to Providence Hospital being required to stay in the district. What the investigation can do, though, is make the parent company return financial assets to the city, because here's what the law says. If you're a not-for-profit organization working for a particular purpose, in the case of Providence Hospital, it was to provide healthcare for DC residents, then you cannot waste that asset in a way that hurts the purpose. And so if we find out that there was wrongdoing and we get money, that money will be allocated for healthcare.
And healthcare east of the river.
Correct.
Well, wow, we could talk all day. We're kind of running out of time. I just wanted to go personal for a minute. We're at the UDC television station. Your mom, Dr. Marie Racine, was a distinguished professor here until her retirement. And of course, she's in our prayers and our best wishes.
Thank you.
You're also a son of Haiti.
And yes.
We share that in common kind of. My maternal grandfather was Haitian. And I see you from time to time over at the Haitian embassy. Tell me about how do you stay connected to Haiti?
Well, I mean, I think you started it off there with mom and also, you know, my father, who died in 1991. My mother and father left Haiti when my sister and I were, well, I was only 6 months. Mikhail, my sister, was about 3 years old. We later joined them a couple of years later. My mother and father always preached the history of Haiti, the history of Africa, knowing our story, knowing that we're people of great confidence and dignity and grace. And therefore, you know, every day was a Haitian lesson. I stay involved by actively being engaged with the embassy and a host of not-for-profit organizations.
This has been totally delightful. We'll have to talk again, either online or offline. But again, I feel better knowing that you're at the helm of our legal apparatus in the District of Columbia. Want to know more, but don't have time today, about your future plans. But people are buzzing about Karl Racine, and so we're buzzing here too. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Malveaux.